Can I have your attention, please? In 1997, classical music had been around for exactly 997 years. Seriously, it's on Wikipedia. Everyone quite liked it, but in 997 years, nothing had changed. And then, finally, along came the answer. Graffiti classics came into being, and classical music would never be the same again. A fusion of musical, instrumental virtuosity and dancing all rolled into one astonishing display. Okay, not too much dancing. There's a limit to what you can do with a violin stuck under your chin. They've dazzled Britain, dumbfounded Europe, conquered the world, and my mum even quite likes them. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is your turn. They've got 16 strings, 8 dancing feet, 4 voices, and 1 modest quest to alter the face of classical music as we know it. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Graffiti Classics.
Hello, we are Graffiti Classics, the comedy string quartet. My name is Cahill, and I play the double bass.
Hello, my name is Akiko, and I play the violin.
Hello, my name's Charlie, and I play the violin.
My name's Charlotte, and I play the viola.
Graffiti Classics is a string quartet with a difference. We don't sit down when we play like traditional orchestras. Instead, we jump around, sing and dance, and generally have lots of fun. We enjoy ourselves even more when we know that you are involved in our music making. So we're really excited for you to be connected with us today. We want you to get involved with our next song by clapping along.
Hello, how's it going there, everybody? You're all very welcome to our back garden. We're here today and we're going to do a bit of a show for you all. We hope that you're all safe and sound and healthy and well in these very strange times. Here we go. Do you know what? Let's try this. When you're at home now, or in school, or wherever you are, whenever I do that, I want you all to clap your hands. So when I hit it, you clap your hands. Are we ready? Are we ready, guys? Here we go.
Yeah.
This is great fun, isn't it?
Yeah.
The sun's out, what more do we want? Come on, clap. Thank you.
Did you all enjoy clapping along?
We can see you when you don't join in, you know.
Why don't we all introduce our instruments? I play first violin, and I play all the high notes.
I play second violin, and that's exactly the same instrument as Akiko, but I play lower notes to complement her tune.
I play the viola, which is a slightly bigger instrument than the violin, so I can play low notes.
Yes, and I play the double bass, which in fact is the lowest instrument in the orchestra. It's called the grandfather of the orchestra. Believe it or not, not one human being in the whole wide world can sing as low as the double bass, and the double bass is pretty low. Here is the string family. There are actually four string instruments in total. Look at the difference in size. There's a violin, viola, cello, and double bass. Which string instrument is missing from the quartet today? Two of us are playing the same instrument. Which is it? Answers on the worksheet. Every string instrument has the same structure. There's always a bridge, a tailpiece, a fingerboard, a scroll, four tuning pegs, two holes that look like an S. Our instruments are extremely fragile because they're hollow in the middle. Nowadays, strings are made of steel. But would you believe they used to be made from guts, from sheep, cattle, or even kangaroos and water buffalo? Disgusting! Listen to how the music texture is built, with each instrument weaving different musical lines. Can you hear each solo? Thank you.
Let's talk about our bows. Without our bows, we'd only be able to pluck. Plucking is called pizzicato.
Bows are made of wood and horsehair.
Nay!
I think that's a bit over the top.
We use this stuff called rosin. It's sap from tree bark, and it helps the hair to stick to the strings.
And even though the double bass is the biggest instrument, would you believe it has the smallest, shortest bow?
Bad luck, Carl. When we look at the score, we know when to play with our bows because it says arco.
Arco!
La comparsita tango.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Listen to when we play pizzicato and arco in this piece.
Thank you.
That piece was called The Tango. It was written in Uruguay in 1917 by Gerardo Rodriguez.
Hola!
The tango is a famous dance, and it's one of my favorites on Strictly Come Dancing.
When I play the tango, I'm transported to a holiday I had in Cuba.
When I play, I'm often transported to different places, which is very handy when you've been in lockdown for so long.
The next piece of music will transport you somewhere in the world. Listen carefully and tell us afterwards if you can tell us where the story has taken place.
Yee-haw!
The devil went down to Georgia, he was looking for a soul to steal. But then I find, cause he was way behind, he was willing to make a deal. When he came across this young man, saw him on a fiddle and played it hot. The devil jumped up on Hickory Stump and said,
"Boy, let me tell you what, I guess you didn't know it, but I'm a fiddle player too. And if you care to take your dare, I'd make the best with you. Now you play pretty good fiddle, boy, but give the devil his due. I bet a fiddle of gold against your souls of pink, I'm better than you."
The boy said,
"Johnny, and it might be a sin, but I take your bet you're gonna regret some of the best there's ever been."
Johnny, rise up, fellow, and play a fiddle hard, cause that's what this thing you're here, and the devil has a cost. And if you win, you get this shiny fiddle made of gold, and if you lose, the devil gets your soul.
Ha ha ha!
Up his case and he said,
"I'll start the show."
And fire flew from his fingertips as he rosined up his bow. As he pulled the bow across the strings, they made an evil hit. And a band of demons joined in, and it sounded something like this.
Johnny said,
"Well, you're a pretty good old son, but sit down in the chair right there, let me show you how it's done.
Fire in the matter, run boys, run. Devil in the house with the rising sun. Chicken in the bread pan, picking out dough. Friendlies in the by no child though.
Well, the devil bowed his head because he knew that he'd been beaten. And he laid that golden fiddle on the ground at Johnny's feet. And Johnny said,
"Devil, just come on back if you ever to try again. I told you once, you son of a gun, the best there's ever been.
You play!
Fire in the matter, run boys, run. Devil in the house with the rising sun. Chicken in the bread pan, picking out dough. Bread is not by no child, no.
Yee-haw!
You can tell us after the show in our live chat what you thought about that piece. It's actually my favourite. I can tell you it is from the bluegrass genre, so maybe you can tell us where it came from.
Of course, we are Graffiti Classics, and although we love playing music from all genres of music, we especially love to play music from the classical period.
Well, I like Bach, and he was a Baroque composer.
Thank you.
I really like romantic composers like Tchaikovsky and Ravel.
But the most famous composers of all must include Beethoven and Mozart. In fact, we're going to play now Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. And we're going to play it in the Graffiti Classics way. Canon is a melody played and then imitated one or more times after a short delay. You might have sung, "Row, row, row your boat gently along the stream. Three blind mice, Frère Jacques, Frère Jacques." This is one of the most famous canons of all, written by a Baroque composer, Pachelbel.
Hello!
Akiko starts playing the famous tune. And then listen out a few bars later. Charlie joins in, but plays exactly the same thing. And then listen out a few bars later. Charlotte joins in and plays exactly the same thing again. And the harmony builds instrument by instrument. So this is a song called Dynamite. We've put the lyrics on a worksheet and looked forward to maybe hearing recordings of you singing it back to us one day.
And it goes on and on and on, yeah. I throw my hands up in the air sometimes, singing ayo.
I throw my hands up,
baby,
let's go.
And it goes
singing
on.
I throw my hands up,
baby,
let's go.
And it goes on.
I throw my hands up,
baby,
let's go.
And it goes on and on and on and on.
Baby, let's go.
And it goes on and on and on.
And it goes on and on and on. Yeah.
In graffiti classics, we always want to innovate and explore our instruments to the max. As well as playing beautiful music, we also love playing unique sounds.
Does this sound like a seaside breeze?
What shall we do with a drunken sailor? What shall we do with a drunken sailor? Early in the morning. Hooray and up she rises. Hooray and up she rises. Hooray and up she rises. Early in the morning. Put him in a longboat till he's sober. Put him in a longboat till he's sober. Put him in a longboat till he's sober. Early in the morning. Hooray and up she rises. Hooray and up she rises. Hooray and up she rises. Early in the morning.
We hope you enjoyed that journey across the open seas with the sailor's hornpipe, and that you could hear the seagull screeching, the boat creaking, and maybe even you felt a bit queasy from the boat swaying. Sorry about that. Isn't it amazing how our instruments can create that scene? And did you sing along? Normally, Graffiti Classics travels all over the world doing shows and workshops. We've got to tell you that this is a first for us, doing a show in a back garden. We're all adapting.
Our wish is that we inspired you to maybe start learning a musical instrument and keep practicing whatever instrument you already play. Remember, practice makes perfect, and with practice, you really start having fun with your music making.
Boo! Today, you've made music with us by listening, clapping, and singing along. We've given you some interesting facts about our instruments and also introduced you to important composers from the Baroque, Classical, Romantic and Contemporary periods. But mostly, we hope we've inspired you to ask us lots of questions about music making in our live Zoom chat afterwards. See you in a minute, but first, let's play Offenbach's Can Can!
Thank you.
And I really hope that you all enjoyed that performance as much as I did. In fact, I know you did because you've been emailing and tweeting in to tell us how much you're enjoying it. The musicians from Graffiti Classics created that performance especially for all of you to watch at home and school. And you're the first people ever to see it. So we're really, really excited. My name's Emily, and I'm thrilled to be joined this afternoon by the musicians from Graffiti Classics and Sarah and Yvonne from Cumbria Music Hub, who commissioned today's performance. They're all here, ready to answer all of your questions. And thank you so much to everybody who's sent in your questions by email and Twitter today. We've heard from schools all over the country and from individual young people. We've heard from Brook Street School, St. Vegas, Corpus Christi, Tockworth, Milnthorpe and St. Cuthbert's and many more. And I'm going to start off with some of your questions now. And we'll see with these fast players how many, how talkers they are and how many questions we can fit in today. So I'm going to kick off with a question that I'd like Charlie to start with, please, Charlie Cole. Charlie, is a question we've had from so many children all over the country, including Lacey, Eva, Charlie, and the key worker Bubble from Milnthorpe. They all want to know, how can you bounce around and play your instruments at the same time? How does that work?
Okay, well, it kind of works in a similar way to how you learn to play the instrument in the first place. It's all about repetitive practice, really, and painstakingly training. The other thing is the choreography that we do. When you see us doing the little individual steps, most all of them, in fact, are usually kind of in time with the music, which makes it a lot easier to process in our heads. If we were doing steps which were, if they were off the beat, it'd be almost impossible. But we make it a little bit, not easier for ourselves, because this is pretty, it's a pretty weird thing to do, let's face it. But it's, yeah, we make things a bit better of ourselves by having steps that are in time with the music, if that makes sense.
Yes. I wouldn't say you've made it easy for yourselves at all. It still looks quite hard work, but it's great to understand how it's done. Thank you.
It's like driving a car. It becomes second nature after a while.
It certainly looks like it. The next question we've got is for Akiko to start off with, but all of you, it'd be great if you jumped in with your answers as well. A lot of the children would love to know, including the year one children from Milnthorpe Primary, where did you learn to play your instruments?
I learned to play my instrument. I started when I was still living in Japan. And then I also continued studying here in London. And I went to music college here, and then I met all these guys. And yeah.
Great, thank you.
And I started when, if you didn't realize, I'm Irish, so I started playing the double bass and my voice broke. When I was about 11 years old, my voice broke. So when the choir bought a double bass and says, you've got to learn that. And I stuck with the double bass ever since. And then I was lucky enough to get a scholarship to come to London when I was about 18 or 19, and I studied music college here, and I've never left.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. We've got a question for Charlotte now. We heard from Carhill what his favourite song is to play, and it's one of my favourites as well. What's your favourite song to play out of everything that you play, Charlotte?
I really like to play A Fifth of Beethoven, which is the more disco one, and obviously it's taken from a classical piece. It's Beethoven's the first movement of his symphony, but it's been jazzed up, like discoed up, and I like that I get to dance while I'm playing in a disco style, so that's my favorite one.
Brilliant, thank you. It's great to see how you've brought all these other genres into what, as you say, Graffiti Classics performance, but there's so many other genres in there, and it's great to see how you can dip in and out and weave all of those together. Really exciting. Quite a few people would like to know whether any of you play any other instruments as well as the ones we've heard about today. Tansy is really enjoying learning to play the flute. She wants to know if any of you play the flute, and do any of you play other instruments? I'll go back to Charlie Cole, who we started with first.
Yes, I personally do. I started as a piano player when I was five, and I still play the piano sometimes mostly like pop and kind of alternative-y stuff. I also sing a little bit, and I used to be a drummer. And that's about it, as far as I can remember. Oh no, wait a minute! I used to play the clarinet. Always forget about that.
So you used to be a drummer, but you're better now. Is that the?
yeah, I mean, I have more free time on my hands, so I might even go back to it at some point.
Brilliant, great, thank you. Does anyone else play any other instruments than what we've seen?
I play the Uilleann pipes, the Irish pipes, not the bagpipes you blow into. They're called the Uilleann pipes, and the reason you call the Uilleann pipe because Uilleann is Irish for elbow, and you pump them up at your elbow, so they're called the elbow pipes or the Uilleann pipes. And I don't play the flute, but I do play the tin whistle. And the tin whistle is one you blow into like a recorder, but it's got 6 holes, not 8 holes.
Brilliant, thank you.
And Charlie, you play this one, do you?
I play the, I play the bass guitar.
Nice.
Yeah, which is fun.
Brilliant, thank you. So we heard that your music has taken you all over the world. And as you've spoken about, you as an ensemble actually come from all different parts of the world as well. What is your favourite country that you visited to play your music? And we'll start again with Akiko, because we heard you started learning to play in another country and then came here. What's your favourite country where you've performed?
Well, we've really been all over, and I really mean all over the world. We've been to America, we've been to obviously all over Europe, we've been to Asia, we've been to Africa, India, you know, everywhere. And I have to say, personally, I really enjoyed playing and being in Africa, of all the places, because it was so different. We played in a music festival in Zimbabwe a few years ago, and you know, that was a blast. And, you know, and we met the locals there, and they were so warm and so friendly, and they really responded really well to what we were doing, because it was so wildly different to their music, you know. And it was wonderful.
Brilliant.
That's right, really.
I guess you got to learn about even more musical genres and maybe musical instruments there as well.
Yeah absolutely. They have these these finger percussions, it's called finger piano. There's a name for it that I've just completely, it's lost on me right now. I know what it's called, but it's just gone. But yeah, they have this instrument there, you know, all their traditional instruments that we were introduced to, and they were really cool.
Brilliant. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay, this is definitely a question for Carl, I think. We have a group of children would like to know how heavy your instrument is, and other people have asked how big is a double bass. You said it's the biggest instrument in the orchestra. Well, how big?
Well, it's right there, but that's my baby behind me. It looks quite small from there because it's quite far away. But if I go get it and show you how big it is compared to my body, okay? Here we go. So if I bring it over here, I'm sitting down right now. So that's how big it is. So it's quite enormous. So if I lift it up like that, it's quite heavy. It's about as heavy as my 6-year-old daughter.
Wow.
And she's very light. I'll put it back. Sorry.
So is that hard work when you're traveling all around the world then? And you talked about how delicate the instruments are. They're all made out of thin, thin wood. So do you have to be really careful when you're out and about?
Well, yeah. In fact, my double bass, I've got a fold-up double bass that I travel around the world with. And it folds up into a suitcase. It's like a flat-pack double bass. There's only about 14 or 15 of them in the world. And that's what we travel with. But for the violins, they're very lucky because they can take their instruments on the airplane with them as hand luggage. But my
poor with no problems.
And my instrument has to go in the hold with all the heavy luggage. So I've got a special flight case to keep it safe.
Brilliant. Thank you. So we've got a question about how many performances you do. So obviously this year's been a bit different. How many performances do you normally do a year? And how many have you done this year? Have you had to do a bit fewer, I guess, this year?
Yeah.
Where should we go first? Charlotte.
Oh, Yeah, no, we haven't really. It's been quite, it's been a bit impossible, actually. So doing this performance was fantastic for us because it meant we all got to play together. But things are, you know, on hold for everyone who plays music at the moment, which is really sad, but we're all hoping that we get to, we get to do it again soon because we love playing together. So, yeah.
This year alone, we did our last performance on the 20th of March when the country went into lockdown. And before then, I actually wrote a list. We started off the year going to Stockholm, then we went to Helsinki, then we went to Edinburgh, then we went to Madeira, then we did a tour of Ireland, then we went out to Barbados, and then we did Solihull, Sudbury, and Winchester. That was all between January, February, and March. So it was a quite busy start of the year, luckily enough, for the few months we've had off. We're all ready to get back to it now. When it might happen, we don't know.
Brilliant. I hope it happens soon. Carl, a couple of children that you might know, Maeve and Cara, they would like to know, is it hard being, when you do all that travelling, is it hard being away from home?
Sorry. Oh, my children put me on the spot. Yes, it's actually been an amazing few months being in lockdown because I see so much of my family. And it's time you would never replace again. That's the one good thing about this lockdown. But the most difficult thing about being away is missing your family. And yeah, so it's hard living out of a suitcase and being away, but it's really, really cool being a musician and seeing the world. But it's difficult also being away and missing your family a lot.
Yeah, I bet. Charlie, Cole, we had a you talked before about how you sort of when you're moving around, you're moving around, your choreography is to the beat of the music, which helps. As an ensemble in general, how do you all keep in time? How does that work?
So when you begin to train as a musician, especially in the UK, actually, very early on in your training, you're kind of put into ensemble environments quite quickly. So you're playing with other people like very, very early on. So it's not just the UK, it's a lot of places, but it's mostly well known here for like being basically, it's well known for being able to show up to a gig and be able to just do it without any rehearsal. And that's because we've been all trained to use our ears like really, really acutely and sharp so that we can just blend in straight away and so no one sticks out like a sore thumb. And then the other thing is when we're all practicing individually, we have what's called a metronome, which is our worst enemy, but it's one of those things that goes tick tock, tick tock, not a clock.
Yeah.
And that helps us keep in time as well, but we're mainly using our ears and our eyes, our toes. Sorry. Yeah.
Brilliant. Talking of toes, we've had a question from Robbie, which may or may not be more for Akiko and Charlotte. How do you manage to perform in high heels?
Oh, gosh.
Ooh,
it's quite a lot of practice. Yeah, maybe. And endurance. Yeah.
I think you get used to it.
Yeah, you do after a while, for sure. Yeah. But, you know, like what Charlie Cole said earlier, you know, it's a lot of kind of practicing and, you know, and like what Charlie's talk just said also, it is kind of getting used to it. And then you know, it becomes kind of, you know, second nature. But when I first had to wear those heels and kind of jump around, like actually physically jump, land, or, you know, kick, like the can-can, oh my gosh, it was so hard. I was like wobbling around going, oh.
Me too.
I think you have to. I find that I'm very much more on like maybe like a dancer would be on the ball of your foot.
Yeah.
So if you, you're kind of, your weight distribution changes a bit, I think. So in order to kind of stop you falling over, you tend to kind of dance as though you were, I don't know, in ballet shoes or something, be more on the ball, which helps, I think.
But yeah.
We're also lucky that this video was shot in the sun. Because it was shot in the garden in the wet weather, they would have gone through the grass with their heels.
Yeah, that wouldn't have been good. That wouldn't have been easy.
So we've got quite a few people are intrigued by the name of the group, Graffiti Classics. It's a great name and it conjures up all sorts. How did you come up with that name? Where did it come from?
Well, the idea is that we play the classics, and we play the classics that everyone would know. So every piece of music we play, we hope that everyone has heard it before or they already know it. And then we try to make all the classics colourful and enjoyable for everyone by adding movement and adding a little bit of oomph to the music as well. So we draw graffiti over the classics to make it enjoyable for everyone. So that's why we called ourselves Graffiti Classics.
Brilliant. And how did you all meet? How did you all get together as an ensemble? Did you all join at the same time? Have some of you joined later?
I think I joined probably the last one out of this group, but then even then, that was how many years ago now? That's 5-6 years ago.
6 years ago, I reckon.
6 years ago, yeah.
Yeah, we've a revolving door of about people last for about 7 or 8 years, yeah. And then classical musicians generally want to move on to join orchestras or get a more stable life. And stop, because as I said earlier, the travel is really cool, but it becomes very tiring. And lots of people want to settle down on land and start teaching and doing things like that.
Yeah. So the life of a musician can have lots of different sort of stages. So you can start off doing one thing and then having all sorts of exciting experiences traveling the world, and then settle down and do something a little bit different, but still earning your living as a professional musician.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, I'll maybe start with Charlotte for this one. Did you always want to be a musician? Like when you were little, is this what you want? Did you know it was a job?
It's funny. I actually just remembered that I wrote in a class once. We had a project to do in primary school. And I did start when a string quartet came to my school, a bit like everyone seeing this video today, and I saw the video and I thought, wow, this sounds incredible. And so I went home and spoke to my mum, and I started having lessons on the violin because I liked the sound of the violin. And then later on I did a project where we had to write about ourselves, and I found a little bit of writing where I did actually say I want to play the violin, I want to be a violinist, but I mean, I play the viola now more often.
but
it's funny, I did want to do that. I just knew, I think people just go with the sound that they like, you know, and see other people playing and then want to do it.
Definitely. Well, that's great to hear. I've got another life of a musician question coming up. I'm going to start with Charlie for this one. And it's a question that I think a lot of young people who are learning instruments ask a lot. How often do you practice? I think okay, we'll go Charlie yeah, to everyone with that after
as Charlie. In me, Charlie, or the other
yeah.
Charlie?
Yeah, yeah,
okay. I'm going to be incredibly honest, actually. What I'm going to so basically the important thing is to do as much practice as you can when you're younger. I think the time I did the most practice was between the ages of about 17 and 23. I was consistently doing anything between 3 and 5 hours of practice a day, which to some actually might not be a lot. There are other people who practice 12 hours a day, but that's pretty obsessive. Anyway, so that's the time I did most practice. But being very honest, when you go out and start working, the amount of time you have to practice decreases, just because you are playing a lot anyway. And then just life happens, and you have to sort of, it doesn't just become about practicing your instrument, it becomes about being a businessman, essentially, and learning how to market yourself and learning how to make money, really. So nowadays, at the age of 31, I being very, very truthful, I think on an average week, I would say I probably do a few hours of practice per week. But around that, I'm playing all the time.
Yeah.
So working is like practicing anyway. Whoa, okay. Working is a sort of practicing anyway, because you're always learning new things. But yeah, it's important to practice more when you're younger, and then you'd have to practice as much when you're older, and that's the best way.
So I do exercise, Charlie, isn't it? You have to keep your fingers moving and keep everything going, kind of like if you did a bit of exercise every day, you know.
But the important thing is, if you pick up a musical instrument today as a child, just enjoy it, do a bit, maybe pick it up every day for about 5-10 minutes and just play a little bit of a tune, and just try and do a little bit of practice every day.
Yeah.
And practice makes perfect. But what Charlie's talking about is when we progress into being professionals, that's great. But just when you're starting off, just play a little bit every day and just try and have fun. So it's all about having fun at the end of the day.
Yeah,
I agree.
Mm.
Brilliant, sounds good. I've got a couple of questions about where you normally play music. Obviously, we've seen you playing music in a garden today, which is quite exciting. And I know some of us were wondering earlier what all the neighbours thought when they were peering through and seeing you all doing your performance. What is the strangest venue you've ever played at, Charlotte?
I found this really difficult because we play in so many different places and so many different countries. I was really trying to think hard about that, and I was actually going to say that I thought playing in Carl's garden was one of the strangest places, because playing on grass was just completely different feel to being on a stage where it's smooth and you kind of know where you're going to land if you jump in the air. But then, having said that, knowing where you're going to land when you jump in the air is also very strange when you play on a ship. And quite often we play on a big cruise ship or cruise ships. And sometimes they're very big, and sometimes the sea can be very rough. And it means that when you're playing a piece like the Can-Can, where we're jumping and we're, you know, kicking our legs in the air and jumping up and down, sometimes if the boat's moving a lot, when you come back down, you don't know quite where you're going to land. So it's a very strange feeling. So I think that although for us it's become quite normal playing in the middle of the ocean, it's actually quite a strange place to play, I think, and to physically get used to that, especially if you aren't very good with the sea, and if you feel a bit woozy or something. So we've had people before going on sometimes just feeling so very ill, but just managed to carry on and get the show done.
The life of a performer. Charlie, can you beat that for strangeness?
Well, talking of feeling ill, I just thought, I mean, especially now looking back on it, I think that the strangest place I've ever played with these other three people was a traditional Chinese theatre in, of all places, the city of Wuhan, the birthplace of a certain thing that's caused us to not play for a while. But it wasn't just the fact that it was in Wuhan, it was a very interesting place, because it doesn't look like a typical theatre. Like, all the design of the architecture and the design was very different, and all the audience wasn't just rows of chairs, it was tables. And then also, in terms of strangeness, just the response from the audience is also very, very different over there as well.
But Charlie, do you remember that same tour? We went to the highest theatre in the world, and our ears were popping the whole day. We couldn't breathe on stage.
The altitude was so high in the province that we were in. It was like right up in the west of China, really cold. And just breathless all the time. That was weird as well.
Wow. thank you all so much. I've got two more questions for you all before we very sadly have to say goodbye. I think we could go on asking you questions for such a long time. The first question, which is just a one word and a very short sentence question for all of you, and I'll start with Akiko for this one, is could you tell us who your favourite composer is, please?
Bartok, Bela Bartok.
Thank you. And we'll go to Carl next.
Beethoven.
Brilliant. Charlotte.
It's a very difficult question because it's like, what's your favourite song?
One sentence, mate.
It's not fair. So I don't choose the questions. They were sent to me. Charlotte, I'll ask you this difficult question. Then we've got an even harder one coming up.
Well, Cahal, I know, feels the same, but traditional folk music is often written by different people and you don't actually know who, but I like the sound of traditional folk music from Ireland and around the world. That's right. A vague answer, but...
brilliant answer. And Charlie, I'll ask you the same difficult question.
Can I give a non-classical answer?
Yeah.
Black Sabbath.
Brilliant.
I honestly think they're one of the most incredible bands, groups of musicians ever to have walked this earth. They're amazing songwriters, musicians. Anyway, that was my answer.
That's wonderful. That gives us lots for all the young people watching to go and explore, so they can go and explore, you know, dark rock music, folk music, all of Bartok, all of these different composers and styles after this. So we've got a musical joke that's come in from Hannah at St. Vega School, and she would like to say, knock, knock.
Who's there?
Thank you. Piano.
Piano who?
Piano woohoo. And I think that's a thumbs up, no excitement at today. And I'm just wondering, and nobody has to do it if they don't want to, but has anyone got a musical joke to share with our audience before we say goodbye? Put your hand up if you do, Charlie.
This is one for the adults as well. So how does Bob Marley like his sandwiches? We're jamming. Yeah. Anyway.
Okay, Sarah.
Oh, mine. So, what do you call a cow that plays a violin? A musician.
Oh, great.
Charlotte, did you have one?
What do bunnies like to listen to?
What?
Hip hop.
Oh.
Any more? Nico, did you have one?
Yeah, I do actually.
Great.
What's the difference between a violin and a fish? God. You can't tune a fish.
And Carl.
Tell the lockdown joke.
What is Beethoven's favourite fruit? Banana.
Nice to end on a musical note. Thank you all, guys, for your fantastic jokes, your amazing musicianship, and for pulling together this performance at such short notice and making it such an exciting performance for all of our young people watching to take part in. I know we wanted to mention Matthew Barlow, who helped you stitch it all together as well. So thank you to that. Before we say goodbye to you all, I'd just like to hand over to Sarah and Yvonne from Cumbria Music Hub, because they can tell us a little bit about how you can all get involved in music, particularly if you live in Cumbria, and about what services Cumbria Music Service can offer. So I'll hand over to you guys and then we'll say bye.
Thanks, Emily. Hello to all our Cumbrian schools. I hope you really enjoyed that. And thank you so much to Graffiti Classics for a brilliant, brilliant concert. I've really enjoyed it and really nice to chat to you, to see that you're real people playing fantastic music as well. So if anybody's been inspired to play a musical instrument, get in touch with us. Have a look at our Cumbrian Music Hub website and our social media pages. and you can see what we've got on there. So Sarah, if you've got something to say.
Yeah, just to say we're planning lots of events for next year. They'll be back on in 2021, big scenes, big plays, Friday lives. And it goes without saying that we really hope that Graffiti Classics will come and visit us in person. So keep in touch, and we may have a few more online things next term, who knows, but keep in touch with all our social media and we look forward to seeing you again soon.
Thanks, guys. Thanks everybody who tuned in today to watch this performance. Thanks again to our amazing musicians who showed us what it's possible to do in a garden with four stringed instruments during lockdown. And it was just a wonderful performance. Those of you who are looking after children, whether that's at home or at school, do go to connectwithsound.live/resources, and you can find a resource pack that these guys have put together to help you do lots of activities linked to today's performance and really get more musical activities happening with your young people. Thanks everybody. I'll just ask us all to give a big wave and say a big bye-bye to you all and see you again soon. One more thing. If you've enjoyed the performance, please complete the questionnaire. Even if there's things that you think we should improve, please let us know your feedback. You can see that underneath this performance here on connectwithsound.live/watch. Tell us what you thought. Tell us what you'd like next. If you'd like Graffiti Classics to come back and do another one, tell us that too. Thanks ever so much, everybody, and bye-bye. See you soon.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.